Hello, welcome back to Let's Play Planescape Torment Blind. I'm the RPG chick. We're about to head into the Clerk Ward. Upper Ward, whatever you call it. Finally! Yeah, we have armor on us, armor spell. That's why we look like that. From last episode. Okay. So I guess the Clerk's Ward and the Upper Ward are the same.
This ward's usually just home to a bunch of scribes, but this section's got the fest hall in it, so it's a little more lively.
Okay, Mort. Actually, useful information from you for once.
If you need to go somewhere, Skull, don't let us keep you.
I have a name, you know.
I have several names for you. None of them fit for polite company.
Clerk's Ward Citizen. Hail, Citizen. This older, well-dressed gentleman is clearly on his way somewhere. Greetings. He stops briefly to look your way, frowning and raising an eyebrow as he takes your appearance in. Finally, he looks you in the eyes. Had some questions. He speaks in a bitter, somewhat condescending tone. A shame, truly. I've no time for your questions. Farewell. Just a single question, then? He sneers slightly. Huh? If I must, go. Ask your question, and be quick about it. What do you know of Ravel Puzzlewell? Only ask one, right? The man is quiet for a moment. I know little, only what I have read in books that mentioned her in passing. What was written of her in these books? Only that she was a creature of utter evil. Many folk think her a myth, but her existence was a documented fact. Sparsely so, but documented nonetheless. Of her fate following her attempt to ruin Sigil, I believe she was banished to one of the Lady of Pain's mazes. Can anyone reach these mazes? No more questions. Find someone else to pester if you must. Farewell. Stop. You'll stand here and answer my questions. He puffs up, stares you in the eye, and bellows. I shall not answer more questions. Away with you, churl, before I call a brace of harmonium officers to hurl your scarred arse from the ward. Farewell, then. Harmonium officer. There's some more people. Diligence? Let's talk to Diligence. This older, stern-looking woman is clearly on her way somewhere. When she notices your approach, she studies you with a disapproving, tight-lipped frown. Greetings. The woman nods curtly, speaking in a tone cold as ice. Yes? What is it? And watch your words, for I am Diligence, fourth magistrate of the ward. You're who? Diligence simply stares at you, a faintly disgusted look upon her face. I have some questions. Diligence smirks. I am no tout, sir, who entertains the questions of passerby for a handful of coins. Find someone else to answer your questions. I have important government business to attend to. I didn't think you a tout, madam. Rather, you appeared most knowledgeable, and I was hoping you could aid me. Just the same, sir, I have no time for your questions. Oh, could be wrong, but I get the distinct impression she might be helpful later. Later on, higher-ups like this, you kind of have to kiss their ass sometimes to get them to help you. So, then I apologize, madam, and I thank you for the time you've given me. Farewell. Oh, well, this helped. Wait a moment. I can see by your manner you are well-educated, sir, yet you appear to insist upon a lifestyle of wandering and senseless violence. Why not settle in Sigil, become a contributing citizen, rather than some bloody-handed nomad in its streets? Well, that's... I thought she was going to help me with some information, but... The choice is out of my hands, I assure you. Oh? How so? Her coldness melts away into a look of curiosity. Yeah, let's tell her the story. Let's tell her what happened. What we know of it, anyway. Diligence looks shocked. That is quite a tale, sir. Were it only a tale, madam. It is my life, and I've the scars to prove it, as you noted when we first met, I believe. Yes, yes, quite so. She smiles slightly. You had begun to wonder if she was even capable of such a thing. I wish you luck, sir, in your undertakings. May you find yourself once more. Thanks. I did have some questions. She shakes her head. I'm afraid I'm a busy woman, sir. My position as fourth magistrate leaves me little time with which to answer your questions. I am sure another citizen could help you, however. Farewell, then, Lady Diligence. Alright. Anyone else coming through here? Matter of course. Get back here. This giant of a man wears an equally immense suit of ornate red armor. He regards you cautiously but without fear as you approach him. Greetings. A booming voice echoes from within his great helm. Greetings, citizen. I am Matter of Course, bodyguard to Diligence, fourth magistrate of the ward. You must excuse me, for my duties lie at her side. Farewell. One moment. I had some questions. He simply turns and begins to walk away. All right. Matter of Course and Diligence. These guys. This large red armored figure is standing in place, carefully watching passersby. You dimly recall that his ornate armor marks him as an officer of the Harmonium, one who provides law enforcement for the city. Dimly recall? I've seen a whole bunch of them in the lower ward, as they're all over the place. Greetings. The man's eyes rove over the ward's inhabitants rather than you when he speaks. Move along. I have some questions. Though most of his attention is still directed at passersby, he takes a moment to look you in the eyes. Nothing for you here. Move along. What if I feel like staying right here? I need your help. He hefts his weapon. You need help? Has a crime been committed? Well, no. I've had some questions. He sighs. I understand you've got questions, and in another time, in another place, I'd be inclined to help. But... He pauses to peer suspiciously at someone walking past, then returns his attention to you. But this is neither, so... Just move along, sir. Now. Okay. Are these all gonna have the same answers? This clean, well-dressed man is clearly on his way somewhere. Greetings. He stops and glances over you. The man seems slightly taken aback at your appearance. Do I, know you, sir? Something troubling about my appearance? No, sir, not at all. The man laughs nervously. Well, he gestures to your scarred, naked torso. You are perhaps a bit more, shall we say, fierce-looking than the ward's typical inhabitants, no? No offense, sir. None taken. I had some questions. I really haven't the time, sir. I've somewhere to go, so if you wouldn't mind. Just a single question, then? He bites his lip, then nods. I won't deny you that, but ask with speed, I beg of you. What do you know of Ravel Puzzlewell? Eh? He seems confused for a moment, then his eyes light up, as if he suddenly remembered something. Ah, the Night Hag, yes? I remember tales I heard of her as a child. Child's tales? He nods. Yes. She's a myth, no? The hag who tried to break sigil? He suddenly frowns. I'd really best be going, sir. Farewell. Wait. I had another question. I had time for one question, sir. Perhaps you shall find someone with more time at one of the street-side cafes. Now, farewell. Stop. You'll stand here and answer my questions. Sir, I have neither the time nor the inclination to be harassed at this moment. I ask of you now. Leave me be. Lest I be forced to call for aid. My apologies. Farewell. So as far as these quests... I think I know what the knife is. It's that ghoul in the Dead Nations who's holding a special knife, and I offered him some rat tails, but he wanted something more. So... I believe that's Uhir's lucky knife. I didn't make the connection, and I kind of forgot about that ghoul for a while. So, I'm not sure what he'd want. Maybe he'd want some more rat tails, or maybe he'd want something completely different. In any case, it was nothing that I had on my inventory at that moment that I could give him. Requin's Curse of Stench. The person I need to talk to, or the what I'm looking for, is in this ward, so I don't know where the spell ruby is. I haven't found it. I'm not doing the companion selling of the slavery. I need this to do that, so it's really all the same quest. I'm thinking maybe I'll find a vial of skin and blood, or that I can put my skin and blood into in the clerk's ward here. And the night hag, of course, I'm going to keep asking. So hopefully I'll find something like that here. You can't determine what this odd device is. Looks like some kind of surfboard with a motor attachment. Peering through the cracks in the shutters, you see what appears to be a tailor shop. Alright, let's go this way. Actually, we've got a map here. The Advocate's Home to Under Sigil. Finem the Linguist's Home. Art and Curio Galleria. Curiosity Shop. Shoppy. Apothecary. The Brothel of Slaking Intellectual Lusts. The Tailor, yes. The Civic Fest Hall. Right, so is this all of Sigil? Is this the last area of Sigil? These wrought iron bars seem to serve as decoration rather than security measures. There's Diligence again. Drunken Mage. This older man is staring into his stein of ale, misery etched upon inch into his features. The battered pewter mug is an unusual one, lightly engraved with strange runes and bearded faces, and covered with a coat of thin frost. He looks up as you approach him. Greetings, sir. He seems slightly tipsy. Something wrong? He sighs, belches into his hand, and nods as he takes another pull of ale. Aye, something's wrong, all right. I've gone and lost my apprenticeship. Well, hungover I was, and botched my mentor's last experiment. All for this damned drink. He sneers at the mug in his hand, but in seconds his expression softens and he takes another swig. It ruins everything it does, this damnable drinking of mine. Why don't you stop drinking then?
Updated my journal.
He shrugs and sighs miserably. I simply cannot. I want to, but I cannot. I just need to drink. I try and stay away, but desire eventually overcomes me, and I cannot resist. Such a wreck I've become. He throws back the last of his ale and calls for more. I see. What's that mug you've got there? This? He looks down at the pewter mug. I won this in a dice game. It's enchanted to keep whatever's in it freezing cold. In this case, or in my case, cheap ale. He frowns, rubs at his eyes, and takes another swig of his drink. That's all I wish to know then. Farewell. Nemelle. Sounds familiar. This tall, slender woman, sipping wine from a small ceramic cup, appears to be looking for someone. Her facial features are elegantly exotic, and the woman's ears, though partially covered by her long hair, can be seen to come to sharp points. Greetings. The woman turns to face you. Violet eyes. Cool. Flashing like flawless chips of amethyst. Awesome. Her speech is as music. You can hear a faint musical tinkling, 100 tiny crystal bells, as she speaks. Each word lingers in your ears, as if they were unwilling to relinquish the exquisite sound. I have no idea how to sound like that, guys, so, really, she talks like that. Nemelle turned to face the scarred, dour stranger. She asked what he wished of her. Mort says, wow. Anna says, ha! Anna sneers at Mort. Stop your drool on your leering skull. My, what a hot-blooded little chit. Starved for attention? I could drool over you, too, if you're just jealous. Mort starts floating towards Anna, making wet slavering noises. Oh my god, Mort. Disgusting. Get a hair's breadth closer, Skull, and I'll see to it that not one of your chattering teeth lies within 100 paces of another. Mort stops abruptly, turning away while muttering unintelligibly. You mean she actually got the last word this time? I thought Mort always got the last word. Yes. That's where I know the name Nemelle. She knows the command word. Who told me that? Glaive, I guess. Or Glaive. The stone face in the catacombs. Before I go that far, I'm just going to answer some questions. I had some questions. Nemelle listened to the stranger's questions, but could answer none. He would have to seek his answers elsewhere. But I haven't even asked. Nemelle smiles at you, slowly shaking her head, your face reflected in her shimmering eyes. Frustrated, confused, he at last gave up. It was clear this woman possessed no more knowledge than that was of use to him. Or if she did, she could not be persuaded to share it. What? No. Just let me ask you something. You open your mouth, but no words come out. Try as you might, you cannot question her. Nemelle shakes her head sadly. Farewell, then. Farewell, then, could come out of my mouth. Alright, let me talk to her again. The woman smiles as she greets you, her beauty no less breathtaking than the first time you saw her. Well, it's the same, it's like a second later. Again, she met the stranger. Why, she wondered, could he have come to me once more? Are you looking for someone? Where could she be? Nemelle wondered. Her companion, Elwyn, was supposed to have met her here days ago. This is her talking. The woman sighs miserably. The air around her grows chill with her sadness. How long must she search this vast foreign city before she finds her dearest friend? I could help you find your friend. What does she look like? Nemelle clasps her hands together and bows her head to you. She would be so pleased to hear news of her friend. She told the kind stranger what Elwyn looked like so that he would know her should he come across her. An image forms in your mind, a woman who resembles Nemelle, but with golden eyes and hair of fiery crimson. I'll return if I find her. Farewell.
Updated my journal.
And thus a rotating schedule system could be implemented in order to... Sigh. Nemelle held her breath as the stranger approached her. Had he found Elwyn? She wondered. That's her saying that. I was told you know the command word for this decanter. The woman makes no move to touch or examine the decanter, but only speaks. Nemelle took it from the stranger, turning it in her hands. Had she seen its like before, she thought. Perhaps, yes, she remembered now. She returned the decanter, whispering into his ear as she did so. Okay, so she doesn't have to do anything. All she has to do is stand around and narrate everything, and it just happens.
Updated my journal.
Lost item, gained item. You realize you know the word now. Nildenosage. Nildenosage. Though you're certain the woman never whispered to you, but merely said she did. She blinks at you. Would the stranger leave her now, satisfied with what she had told her? Yes, I will. Farewell. Okay. So I don't know. Right, I lost an item for her to look at it and gained it right away. She didn't really look at it, but she did or something. Decanter of Endless Water with command word. This is an ordinary looking stoppered flask that somehow holds an endless supply of water. You know the command word for this item, Nildenosage, and you're confident you can put out most any fire, no matter how intense. This item can only be used through dialogue with an object or creature. Alright, we might be able to help Ignis now. I don't know, maybe I should look around the rest of the ward first. This looks like a place where drinks might be served. I can imagine it is. Abel Ponderthought. This older man looks somewhat bookish. His clothing and accessories are extremely clean, neat, and well cared for. and he often pauses to brush some fleck of dust or lint off of them. A symbol, resembling a stylized dagger, piercing upwards to a flame, is embroidered upon his tunic. Greetings. The man's eyes pass over you, gleaming as they fix on Mort. Oh, I say, would you look at that? A floating skull. Mort turns and looks behind him. Where? Where? The man gasps. By the unjust laws of Twenty the Merciless.
Who?
He suddenly covers his mouth and looks at Anna apologetically. Sorry. The man was a horrible tyrant, now long dead. His name should never be spoken so. Tis rather vulgar. My dearest apologies, my lady. I did not mean to offend. Anna shrugs, rolling her eyes. Talk as you like, Cutter. I care not a whit for what you say. Unless you're rattling your bone box about me, that is. Okay, I'm going to try to get this guy's attention. He turns back to Mort. But behold, a skull, buoyant, levitating off the ground, cognitive of its environment, and possessing hearing, speaking, and seeing capabilities. He turns to you as if you're suddenly a confidant. This is truly one of the reasons that the planes shall never become dull to me, sir. Just when you think you've seen everything, the planes show you yet another corner to peer around, and... He raises his hands gloriously. Suddenly, whole new, wondrous vistas are open to you. I'm not sure if Mort qualifies as a wondrous vista. The man ignores you, looking to Mort instead. I say, Skull, he begins. Mort gasps. Look behind you! Another floating skull! Let Mort have his fun, absolutely. The man seems to have forgotten you entirely, instead turning in shock to look for this other floating skull. No! Where? Where? Right where I'm pointing. There! Where? I cannot see it. Mort can't point at anything. Mort speaks with mock exasperation. You just missed it. A whole parade of them. Probably never happen again in a million revolutions of the Great Ring. Abel Ponderthought turns and harumphs. I sense you also possess a peculiar degree of mockery. Mort bobs slightly, as if shrugging. I prefer to refer to it as keen eyesights into human nature. Get the man's attention again? It's funny. He suddenly seems to see you for the first time. The man's eyes widen. By the unjust laws of Twenty the... He catches himself, looking apologetic. I say, are you all right? You look... He fumbles for the words. Hurt. I'm all right. Aye, it hurts to look at him, it does. Anna says. An odd comment from someone with what looks to be a giant rat's tail sprouting from her bottom. Anna bares her teeth, tail lashing. Is that so, you pikin' leatherhead? If you wants me, and me tail... If you wants me, what? If you wants, me and me tail can just walk right out of your sight for good. Would that make you happy, eh? No, Anna, stay. I was only teasing. An eye for an eye. Humph! She smirks at you, but makes no move to leave. Thanks, Anna. And you, sir, I had some questions. The man nods, eagerly. Of course. I am always most happy to answer what questions I can, young sir. Finally? I had questions about you. Me? Certainly. Who are you? Why, my name is Abel Ponderthought. What do you do here? I passed my administrator exam just recently and have achieved the status of an A9, a research consultant in the Hall of Records, one of the many aides specializing in Sigil's physical laws and history. I research topics and laws of interest to others. It is quite fascinating, really. Research? Could you look something up for me?
Updated my journal.
I can most certainly try, sir. What is it you seek to know of? Excuse me. I'm looking for information about a night hag named Ravel Puzzlewell. Ravel? If she truly existed, and there is little to prove that she did, was a night hag, one of the inhabitants of the Grey Waste, one of the lower planes, and believed by some to be the worst of the lower planes. He continues, as the legend goes, Rava was mazed several centuries ago. She was believed of being a mistress of many strange magics, and apparently her presence and sigil constituted a threat to the lady. I'm afraid that I know little about her. Mazed? The mazes. These are creations by the lady. You see, she takes a small piece of sigil, copies it, then uses a portal to place the copied bit into the deep ethereal. Once there, the piece of sigil then becomes a demiplane, an endless maze that curls and twists about itself. It continues, the lady uses these mazes to imprison anyone who threatens her power. Once she has determined that you are to be imprisoned, there is no escaping them. There is believed to be a way out of each maze, but it is likely extremely difficult. So can you research her then? Yes, I shall look into it. I shouldn't have the information in less than a day from now. Thanks. Can I ask you to look into something else? I can most certainly try, sir. What is it you seek to know of? I'm looking for information on any deceased person who matches my description. He seems puzzled. An odd request, sir. Such a man or men would have to have been noteworthy figures for my work to turn up anything of interest. Are you investigating an ancestor of yours, or something like that? Can you check? Yes, I shall look into it. I should have the information less than a day from now. And actually, let me ask about something else. What's that symbol embroidered on your tunic mean? Why, 'tis the symbol of the Fraternity of Order. We are responsible for much of the lawmaking and running the courts here in Sigil. Many judges, advocates, and clerks are members of our order, and we are pleased to be able to help enforce Sigil's laws and keep things orderly. We make a strident effort to learn all laws, whether they pertain to Sigil, the planes of the multiverse itself. Whether they pertain to Sigil or the planes of the multiverse itself. Okay, whether they pertain to Sigil, the planes, or the multiverse itself. Sorry. What does the Fraternity of Order believe?
Updated my journal.
The Fraternity of Order believes that the multiverse is governed by laws. When one knows all the laws, one will understand the multiverse. That is our goal. By understanding the laws, their limits, we learn to avoid certain laws. If you don't mind me asking, what sort of benefits are in the position? Well, our fraternity allows us to read languages quite easily, and we may use some rules of the multiverse on occasion to suit our benefits. I had questions about this place. I'll admit I know little of this part of the Clerks Ward, sir, but please, ask. Why is it called the Clerks Ward? It is the seat of much of Sigil's record halls and administration. The staff at these places give the ward its name. Many clerks, scribes, priests, bureaucrats, and administration officials live in this ward. What's of interest around here? There is one of the finest advocates in Sigil located here. The Civic Fest Hall, home of the Society of Sensation, is also located nearby. He lowers his voice. And the brothel, sir, of slaking and intellectual lusts. Tell me of the advocate. He is also one of the Fraternity of Order, though his time there has ebbed somewhat since the unfortunate troubles he has experienced. I am not one to speak of them. His residence is just across the way, south and east of here. Tell me of the Fest Hall. 'Tis a beautiful structure that is both the headquarters of the Society of Sensation and acts as a hall for the arts here in Sigil and the Plains. It is an opera house, museum, art gallery, wine shop, tavern, training hall, theater, sensoriums. Many things can be found there. Sensoriums? Yes, the sensates possess sensory stones, minerals that can store a person's experience within them. Once recorded, anyone may touch the stone and relive the experience stored in the sensory stone. Sensory stone. Quite intriguing, really. Tell me about the Society of Sensation.
Updated my journal.
Ah, the Society of Sensation. They are one of the most prominent of Sigil's 15 factions. They hold a belief that the true dark of the multiverse can be known only by directly experiencing as much of the universe as possible, tasting every substance, feeling every range of emotion, and visiting every place in the multiverse. He continues, their faction headquarters is at the Civic Fest Hall, where they seek to bring experiences to all of Sigil. At the moment, they are the most numerous faction in all of Sigil, and the most powerful. If I am not mistaken, the most recent census of their membership is over 20 times 1,000 members. Know of any work available locally? None of the temporary sort, no. Okay, on to the next thing. I had questions about this city. Questions about Sigil? Please, sir, ask whatever you like. I'm curious about the Lady of Pain. Lady of Pain, yes, yes. She is the force behind Sigil, you know. Very impressive figure. But little is known about her. What is known about her? He begins ticking off the points on his fingers. One, she is not just a symbol of Sigil, as some claim. She is very real and very dangerous. Two, she is believed to be the one that keeps the powers, deities, out of Sigil. As long as she is present, the powers cannot enter Sigil. Three, she also prevents unauthorized teleporting and gating into and out of Sigil. It prevents the Outer Planes creatures from bringing even more of their kind to Sigil outside of the conventional routes. 4. She has never spoken to anyone. 5. She usurped control of Sigil from Aoskar, a power now believed dead. Aoskar. Sounds familiar. Aoskar. 6. Anyone who threatens Sigil or her is punished, either by falling beneath her shadow, which results in a series of invisible stab wounds that can kill even greater Batezu, or by being sent to the mazes, from whence few ever escape. 7. She is not like to be worshipped. Those that do are often found with their skin missing. And lastly, the sight of her is believed to drive others mad. She stole control of Sigil from a power? How do you know this? 'Tis the belief of my order. You said the sight of her drives people mad? Yes. He ponders it for a moment. But I must add the caveat that I have never seen her, you understand? So, how is it that you know that she created Sigil? This is a belief in my order. Yes, about the factions first. Curious about the factions. Yes, there are 15 factions in Sigil. Once there were 49 factions, then about 600 years ago. The Lady of Pain let it be known that only 15 would remain. That was known as the Great Upheaval. Wow, I'm getting a lot of interesting information from this guy. And sure enough, in a fortnight, 34 of them perished or faded. Many thousands died by sword or other means. Many were simply found dead. I, myself, am a member of the Fraternity of Order. Others include the Believers of the Source, the Dustmen, the Harmonium, the Mercy Killers, the Revolutionary League, the Society of Sensation, and the Zaos Attacks. Okay, we've already... He's in the Fraternity of Order. Tell me of the Fraternity of Order. Okay, that... Alright. Tell me of the Believers of the Source.
Updated my journal.
The Believers of the Source, or Godsmen, believe that every living thing in the multiverse has the potential to become a power. Okay, why am I updating my journal? I know that already. The Godsmen have their headquarters in the Great Foundry, and they have helped to keep peace in Sigil in a number of matters. They have no desire to see any creature placed in the dead book before it has a chance to reach its potential. I'm not even going to say, because he might not help me if I tell him I'm part of the faction. Dustman.
Updated my journal.
The Dustmen believe we are already dead, that Sigil and the Planes are where we all end up after we die. According to their beliefs, everything is dead and this existence is a false one. To keep any ties or feelings for this existence only prevents a soul from truly dying. You see, the Dustmen believe that death in this existence is a matter of degree, and only those who are truly dead and have divested themselves of all ties to this existence can hope to be at peace. A philosophy that has some basis in fact, but much of it bears further examination. Tell me of the Harmonium.
Updated my journal.
The Harmonium is devoted to peace and harmony throughout the planes, thus their name. They believe that the end justifies the means, however, and so are willing to do just about anything to get a fellow to see things their way. Regardless of one's personal opinion of them, they do a fine job of policing Sigil streets. Mercy Killers.
Updated my journal.
The Mercy Killers believe that justice is everything. Malin, their last factol, once said that when properly applied, punishment leads to perfection. Those new to Sigil oftentimes commit the error of thinking their name implies that they kill out of mercy. Rather, though, it is that they seek to kill mercy itself. Their faction members take it upon themselves to punish the guilty of Sigil, whatever the cost. The Revolutionary League. I haven't heard of them, I don't think.
Updated my journal.
Oh, okay. Never mind. They are also called the Anarchists. Not many know this, but the Revolutionary League is actually quite widespread in Sigil. And a shame, that is, too. They hold the misguided belief that all institutions have been established to block their access to the truth of the multiverse. The only way they see to discover the truth is to tear down all organization. They claim that the truth can only be discovered when people are completely free. He shakes his head. I often wish that they would open their eyes to the truth around them. They do nothing but blind themselves and block everyone's access to the truth. He gives a long sigh, then wags his finger disapprovingly, as if talking to some imaginary bad child. It is interesting to note that they have no real plans for seeking the truth past tearing down everything that they can see. Very interesting indeed. This guy is going off. He frowns. It is also of interest that while the Revolutionary League has a large number of members, the very nature of their faction causes these members to work counter to each other's interest. Often, cells fight amongst each other, each one claiming to know the proper way to go about tearing everything down. Tell me of the Society of Sensation. Ah, the Society of Sensation. They are one of the most prominent of Sigil's 15 factions. They hold a belief that the true dark of the multiverse can be known only by directly experiencing as much of the universe as possible, tasting every substance, feeling every range of emotion, and visiting every place in the multiverse. Their faction headquarters is at the Civic Fest Hall, where they seek to bring experience to all of Sigil. At the moment, they are the most numerous faction in all of Sigil, and the most powerful. If I am not mistaken, the most recent census of their membership is over 20 times 1,000 members. Tell me of the Zeos attacks.
Updated my journal.
He harumphs. Rabble-rousers. Not a proper faction at all, that raggedy bunch. Why, even the Revolutionary League is more organized. The Zeos attacks think that, by embracing chaos, they'll somehow discover the secrets of the universe. Ridiculous notion. Let me ask about daylight, and then... Where's daylight here come from? I don't see a sun. The haze can make it difficult to determine for certain, so I understand your difficulty. The light comes not from a sun, but from a gradual luminescence that fills the sky. It reaches a peak, called peak, then fades until Sigil is completely dark, called anti-peak. The source of luminescence is unknown, but it is most likely the lady's will. I already asked him about the lady. And finally here for Sigil anyway. What's outside of Sigil? No one knows. It is not from want of trying. At the places where no true wall exists are solid walls of buildings, but no windows that look beyond. Some claim to have climbed roofs and seen the outside of Sigil, but they can only describe the outside as nothing. That is an unacceptable explanation, but it still remains a mystery. It is rumored, without fact, that the step beyond Sigil's walls takes a traveler to a random plane, but this has not been confirmed. The Fraternity of Order has mounted many expeditions, and we have yet to concrete information. Hmm. Let me ask about something else. Okay. I have nothing to ask now, actually. Farewell. And that is why the Apparel Regulation Act is of utmost importance. Okay, guys. 40 minutes episode. We've been talking to this guy for a long time. Thanks for watching. See you next time. We explore more of the Clerks Ward, a.k.a. Upper Ward. See you next time, and a bang bang boogie, and don't stop the boogie.